بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه مباركا عليه كما يرضى عنا ربنا. يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك. سبحانك اللهم لا أحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، لا ند له ولا حد له ولا ضد له، فلا راد لحكمه ولا معقب لقضائه ولا رب سواه. ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، خير نبي أرسله الله إلى العالم كله بشيرًا ونذيرًا وداعيًا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجًا منيرًا. صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وصحبه صلاة وسلاما دائمين متلازمين إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وما جعلنا لبشر من قبلك الخلد أفإن مت فهم الخالدون. كل نفس ذائقة الموت ونبلوكم بالشر والخير فتنة وإلينا ترجعون. وقال رسول الله صلى الله تبارك وتعالى عليه وسلم: أكثروا من ذكر هادم اللذات، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. Respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Brothers and sisters, we are living in a time of dispute and disagreement. Almost anything one says is disagreed and disputed. There are people, they have disagreement about the concept of believing in God. There are people who doesn't believe in the hereafter. There are people who disagree about heaven. There are people who disagree about hell. There are people who have difference of opinion about their own existence. There are people, respected brothers and sisters, they do not know why they are here in this world. But there's one thing that is unanimously agreed by everyone, believer, disbeliever, everyone. There's no two different opinion. Something that the Quran calls it al-yaqeen, something that is certain, there is no room for error or doubt. And that is death. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is why he told us that we should remember death. Because there is no two opinion about it. Every one of us has to face death. Respected brothers and sisters, a person who lives in this world, it could be 30 years, it could be 60, it could be 80 or even more. But a day will come, he or she has to face what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed. حُكْمُ الْمَنِيَّةِ فِي الْبَرِيَّةِ جَارِي مَا هَذِهِ الدُّنْيَا بِدَارِ قَرَارِ. The order of death has been decreed on the whole of creation. So this world is not the place of eternal abode. تَفَكَّرْ فِي الْوُجُودِ بِعَيْنِ فِكْرٍ تَرَى الدُّنْيَا الدَّنِيَّةَ كَالْخَيَالِ وَمَنْ فِيهَا جَمِيعًا سَوْفَ يُفْنَى وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ. Ponder over the existence with the eye of meditation. And then you'll see, the Prophet says, that this world is like mere thoughts. And all that is on it will soon come to an end. And there shall remain the countenance of your Lord, Allah Azza wa Jal, the Majestic. A person could be healthy, could be wealthy, could be a minister, could be a barrister, could be a lawyer, could be a farmer, could be poor, could be rich, could be young, could be old, could be a king. But a day will come when his health will leave him, his wealth will leave him, his position will be taken away from him, his kingdom will be snatched from him, his beloved ones will leave him and abandon him, and his kingdom will fade away from him. تَزُولُ عَنِ الدُّنْيَا فَإِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي إِذَا جَنَّ عَلَيْكَ اللَّيْلُ هَلْ تَعِيشُ إِلَى الْفَجْرِ. Imam Shafi rahimahullah ta'ala is reminding us that you are fading away from this world. And in another version he said, تَزَوَّدْ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا, take provision from this world, do some good deeds, because you're moving away from this world. You do not know, when night enshrouds you in darkness, Will you live till dawn? How do you know? Because every breath that we breathe, respected, but it's by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A time will come when we can't breathe anymore. It will be our final breath. It will be our final chance. And this is what someone said, that حَيَاتُكَ أَنْفَاسٌ تُعَدُّ بِهَا فَكُلَّمَا مَضَى نَفَسٌ إِنْتَقَصْتَ بِهِ جُزْءًا. That your life is like a number of breath which you are accounted by. So whenever you breathe, you become that much less. Al-Hasan al-Basri, rahimahullah ta'ala, the famous scholar of Busra, he has said something really wonderful. Something that we should spend a lot of time thinking. He said, يَا بْنَ آدَمْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ أَيَّامٌ فَإِذَا ذَهَبَ يَوْمٌ ذَهَبَ بَعْضٌ. Son of Adam, your life is like a number of days. Whenever a day passes, then some of you have passed. يُسِرُّ الْمَرْءَ مَا ذَهَبَ اللَّيَالِي. You know, people today, they celebrate because they are 20-year-old now, or 30-year-old, or a 40-year-old, or 60-year-old. And you know, people celebrate these days. And this poet here, he said, يُسِرُّ الْمَرْءَ مَا ذَهَبَ اللَّيَالِي وَكَانَ ذَهَبُهُنَّ لَهُ ذَهَبًا. He said, people, the passing of the days makes man happy. He doesn't know that the passing of the day is actually the passing of himself. You are getting closer and closer to your grave. And that's why Imam Shafi is reminding us and he's saying, تَزُلُ عَنِ الدُّنْيَا فَإِنَّكَ لَا تَدِرِي إِذَا جَنَّ عَلَيْكَ اللَّيْلُ هَلْ تَعِيشُ إِلَى الْفَجْرِ. You are fading away from this world. You do not know when night will cover you in darkness, will you live till dawn? Then he said, فَكَمْ مِنْ صَحِيحٍ مَاتَ مِنْ غَيْرِ عِلَّتِي وَكَمْ مِنْ سَقِيمٍ عَاشَ حِينًا مِنَ الدَّهْرِ. How many a healthy person was there? He died without any ailment. This person got no medical record. He was fine. But suddenly, everyone is grieving. So and so have passed away. وَكَمْ مِنْ سَقِيمٍ عَاشَ حِينًا مِنَ الدَّهْرِ. And how many a diseased person was there? Who lived for thousands and who lived for hundreds of years or many years. عَاشَ حِينًا مِنَ الدَّهْرِ. He lived for so many years. People said he doesn't have, he was only a few seconds and he's living for many years. وَكَمْ مِنْ فَتَنْ أَمْسَى وَأَصْبَحَ ضَاحِكًا وَأَكْفَانُهُ فِي الْغَيْبِ تُنْسَجِ وَهُوَ لَا يَدْرِي. And how many youngsters, how many youth was there? They spent morning and evening in laughter whilst his beautiful shroud is already made and woven and he doesn't know. وَكَمْ مِنْ صِغَارٍ يُرْتَجَى طُولُ عُمْرِهِمْ وَقَدْ أُدْخِلَتْ أَجْسَادُهُمْ ظُلْمَةَ الْقَبْرِ. And how many young people were there? Their long life was yet being anticipated. Yes, you know, this person will become something. He has a career. He's got a future in front of him. When his corpses were cast into the darkness of the grave. And then he said, وَكَمْ مِنْ عَرُوسٍ زَيَّنُوهَا لِزَوْجِهَا وَقَدْ قُبِطَتْ أَرْوَاحُهَا لَيْلَةَ الْقَدْرِ. And how many a bride was there? Her friends adored her for her husband. And then her soul was taken on that appointed night. And to conclude, Imam Shafi rahimahullah says, فَمَنْ عَاشَ أَلْفًا أَوْ أَلْفَيْنِ فَلَا بُدَّ مِنْ يَوْمٍ يَسِيرُ إِلَى الْقَبْرِ. So whoever lived for 1,000 years or 2, a day will come that he has to go to his grave. There is no escape from it. You cannot get away from it. No matter how much knowledge and wisdom you have, no matter how advanced the technology is, when the time of death comes, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ الْأَجَلُ, when that fixed time comes, Allah Azza wa Jal says, لَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ سَاعَةً وَلَا يَسْتَخْدِمُونَ. No one can bring an hour forward, nor can they delay an hour. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written the specific time, and even the location as well. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا. No soul knows what it will earn tomorrow. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتُ. No, nor any soul knows in which land it will be his last breath that he will die. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us in so many verses in the Holy Quran that, you know, people today, this is the problem we have. Today we live in this materialistic world that we are neglecting of the remembering about death. We don't want to remember about death because that's the bitter truth. You know, the fact that we're going to die, we don't want to talk about it. We're going to live in rejection. We're going to live in denial. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us. فَلَوْلَا إِذَا بَلَغَتِ الْحُلْقُومِ وَأَنْتُمْ حِينَئِذٍ تَنْظُرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that, then why don't you intervene when the soul reached the throat. And you know, when the soul is moving in the body, there are so many angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they have a job to do. And then finally, the last breath that someone breathes, that is the moment when Malakul Maut comes and he takes it. Otherwise, he has so many employees working for him. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is reminding us that فَلَوْلَا إِذَا بَلَغَتِ الْحُلْقُومِ, when the soul reaches the hulqum, the throat, why don't you intervene? وَأَنْتُمْ حِينَ إِذٍ تَنْظُرُونَ, you are there, looking. وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْكُمْ وَلَكِنْ لَا تُبْصِرُونَ, and we are more closer to him than you. وَلَكِنْ لَا تُبْصِرُونَ, but you do not see us. The angels are there in the room. Only the righteous servants of Allah, they could see those angels. Otherwise, no one sees those angels. فَلَوْلَا إِن كُنْتُمْ غَيْرَ مَدِينِينَ, so if you, one of those who doesn't believe in the recognition and the hereafter, if you think you are exempt from questioning, if you think you are exempt from future account, then Allah again, He asks, فَلَوْلَا إِن كُنْتُمْ غَيْرَ مَدِينِينَ, تَرْجِعُونَهَا, why can't you bring that soul back again? Take that soul back to its place. إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ, if you are truthful. The truth is, no one can do that. The truth is that we have no power. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders the Malakul Maut to come and take the soul away, there is no stopping. We are powerless. No one can do anything. وَجَاءَتْ سَكْرَةُ الْمَوْتِ بِالْحَقِّ ذَلِكَ مَا كُنْتَ مِنْهُ تَحِيدٌ, and then the angel comes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the sakratul maut, agony of death will bring the truth. And the truth will be in front of him. And now he will say, ah, yes, 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 now I can see everything. Sakratul maut, the agony of death, bilhaq, ja'a bilhaq, will bring the truth in front of him. And then the angel will say, ذَلِكَ مَا كُنْتَ مِنْهُ تَحِيدٌ, do you know what? This is what you used to avoid. This is something that you should try from escaping, but there is no escaping today. Sakratul maut, the word sakra in Arabic, it means when someone is drowsy. Sakratul maut is the pain of death. It's from the same root, sakara, it means the pain of death, the agony of death. Something respected about the elders and sisters we all have to go through. Even the prophets, even the saints, the special bondmen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they too have to go through the sakratul maut. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as you know, he was in sakratul maut. And when he was in sakaratul maut, he said, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, inna lil mawti sakara. He said, La ilaha illallah, none is worthy of worship but Allah. Surely I could feel the agony of death. This is, we are talking about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Actually, this pain of death started 11 or 12 days before. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was with his companions. And then he happened to go to Jannat al-Baqi to attend a funeral. And attending funeral at the time of the Prophet ﷺ was very difficult because you have to go to Jannat al-Baqi and it's such a hot day as well and the heat is sometimes unbearable. So Rasulullah ﷺ, he has reached the age of 63 now. But the Prophet of Allah ﷺ used to attend the funeral. He went, and then when he came back, it was toward the end of Safar. We're talking about the month of Safar, last few days of Safar. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came back. When he came back, he came to the room, and it was the room of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. It was her turn today, so the Prophet went to her room. As soon as the Prophet came to the room, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, "Wa ra'sa, wa ra'sa, O Prophet of Allah, I have such a pain in my head." Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Bal ana ya Aisha wa ra'sa, I too, O Aisha, feeling that pain." Then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he rested, and then Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she put a cloth around the head of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then 2 days later, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam health deteriorated, and he asked for some water, and then he said, "I'll give you some water." And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, at that time he was in the house of Maymuna. He had to move from Aisha. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to spend each night in a different house of his wife. He was at that moment at the house of Aisha, Maymuna radiallahu ta'ala anha. And then he said, Aina ana ghadan? Aina ana ghadan? And we are talking about Rasulullah s.a.w. feeling the pain. He is the Khalil, the friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the Habib, the beloved. Rasul of Allah Azza wa Jal. We are talking about him. The Prophet he was going through so much pain that he said, Aina ana ghadan? Where am I going to be tomorrow? Where should I be tomorrow? The wives of the Prophet they understood that the Prophet of Allah he wants to be with Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. So they said, oh Prophet of Allah, you don't have to be here. Go wherever you want to be. So the Prophet of Allah he came to back to the room of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And then he said that I need to speak to the nation. I need to speak to my companions. But whenever the Prophet used to get up, he used to fall down unconscious. They got some water. And Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she put water on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet of Allah sallam, he fell down unconscious. 3 times water was poured into his head. 3 times the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fell down unconscious. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I'm okay now. And then he came to the masjid. When he came to the masjid, the Prophet of Allah sallam, left salah. And after he left the salah, he told the companions to remain. And then the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he spoke. After he left the salah, he spoke to the companions. And various things the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. One of the things that he said, إِنَّ عَبَدًا خَيَّرَهُ اللَّهُ مَا بَيْنَ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا بَيْنَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ فَاخْتَرَ مَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. He said, a servant of Allah has been given the choice. Either he should choose the dunya, or he should choose what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for him. That servant has chosen what Allah has prepared for him. Now we are talking about the gathering of companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the gathering, there were eminent companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the like of Abu Bakr, the like of Umar, Uthman, Ali, Talha, Zubayr, and the like of Abdurrahman bin Auf radiallahu ta'ala anhu ajma'in, and many other companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Everyone remained quiet. You know, suddenly Abu Bakr got up radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he said, "Fadaynaka bi abaina wa ummahatina ya Rasulullah," and he began to weep profusely. Abu Bakr said, may our fathers and our mothers be sacrificed for you, O Prophet of Allah. And he began to weep. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, we don't understand. You know, even the companions, they were elbowing one another. He said, what's wrong with this old Umburu had the Shaykh Mayyukini? What's wrong with this old man? Why is he crying today? Here the Prophet of Allah is saying, a servant of Allah has been given the choice either to choose the hereafter or the dunya. That servant chose the hereafter. What's there to cry about? And why is he crying? Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, he said, only after the demise of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we understood what Abu Bakr understood. وَكَانَ أَبُو بَكْرٍ أَعْلَمَنَا. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he was the most knowledgeable amongst us. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he continued crying. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to say to him, يَا أَبَا بَكْرَ لَا تَبْكِي. Abu Bakr, no need to cry. Abu Bakr, no need to cry, sit down. And then the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he praised Abu Bakr in front of all the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was a clear indication about the khilafah. And one of the things that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said is that لَوْ كُنْتُ مُتَّخِذًا خَلِيلًا غَيْرَ رَبِّي لَاتَّخَذْتُ أَبَا بَكْرٍ خَلِيلًا. If I were to take someone as my intimate friend besides Allah, then I would have taken Abu Bakr to be my friend. لَا يَبْقَيَنَّ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ خَوْخَ إِلَّا خَوْخَ أَبِي بَكْرٍ. All the doors to Masjid al-Nabawi should be shut. Because what happened, the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they had a door. Everyone used to have a door to the masjid. So it's easy access to come to the masjid. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said at the final, you know, towards the end, he said, everyone should close that door. Only one door would remain open, that is the door of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And this door can be seen even today if you visit the Masjid al-Nabawi alayhi salatu wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then he went to his room. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, we already understood that servant that Allah's Prophet is talking about, he's none other than Prophet of Allah himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he doesn't have many days left, he's going to leave us now. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went inside, and then later on he left the salah, again with all this pain that he was going through. On Thursday, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's health was very bad, that he could not get up. But he left the Fajr salah, he left the Zahar salah, he left the Asr salah as well. And Maghrib Salah was the most difficult Salah that the Prophet led. And then it was time for Isha Salah, the Prophet, he couldn't leave his house. From that was the last Salah the Prophet led. Maghrib Salah he could not leave. Isha Salah he could not leave, sorry. And then he said that, Aisha, what's happening outside? Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said, O Prophet of Allah, everyone is waiting for you to go and lead them in Salah. It's Salah al-Isha time. Rasulullah said, I can't move. The pain that I'm going through, I can't take it anymore. مروا أبا بكر فليصلي بالناس. Go, command and tell Abu Bakr that he should lead the people in salah. عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها, she was next to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, she said, يا رسول الله, إن أبا بكر رجل أسيف. O Prophet of Allah, Abu Bakr is a man of soft heart. If he leads the people in salah, he's going to cry. And he will cry so much that the people are not going to understand his recitation. مر عمر يصلي بالناس بالصلاة. Why didn't you command عمر to lead the people in salah? Because عمر was جهوري الصوت. He had a loud voice. You know, those days they never had no microphone, nothing. So عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه, he had a loud voice. It will be appropriate for عمر to lead the people in salah. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, although he was going through so much pain, he said, no. مروا أبا بكر فليصلي بالناس. No, tell Abu Bakr to lead the people in salah. Now Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was there. Now although it was, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was in the house of Aisha, but the door was open for all his wives. Anyone could come in. So his wives used to come and go, and they used to help out, you know, because the Prophet's health wasn't good. Now Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, when he said that Abu Bakr should leave the salah, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said to Hafsa, Hafsa, I need a bit of help here. You know, intercede. And don't forget Hafsa, she's the daughter of Umar ibn Khattab. So he said, I think you should tell the Prophet that your father should lead the people in salah. Hafsa said, no problem. You know, so Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, O Prophet of Allah, I agree with Aisha. I think, you know, Umar should lead the people in salah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again, he turned around and he said, Inna kunna antunna sawahibu Yusuf. You are like the women of Yusuf. Muru Abu Bakr falyusalli bin nas. Go tell Abu Bakr to lead the people in salah. And then they have to go and they told Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu that the Prophet of Allah is commanding you that you should lead the people in salah. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he led the people of salah. Now why did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that you are like the women of Yusuf? You're probably thinking, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is talking about Zulaykha. At the time of Yusuf alayhi salatu wa sallam, Zulaykha, she said something. She said she called all the women of Egypt in the surrounding area to come just to prove them that she seduced Yusuf because of his beauty. Yusuf Aslam was really beautiful and she couldn't stop that. So she called everyone for a da'wah. She said that I'm inviting you all for a dinner. Actually she was hiding something else. Her intention was not to just give food and drink to the people. Her intention was to prove to the women that, you know, anyone could be deluded, or anyone could be deluded because of the beauty of Yusuf. It is not only me. So Rasulullah SAW was saying that Aisha, there's something else that you're hiding. You know, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, later she explained that I didn't want my father to be standing at the same musalla of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because what the people will say then? You know, the love she had for Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anha, you know, Abu Bakr, in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is in the musalla of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, people will have, you know, bad thinking about him. So that was the real thinking that she was having. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he understood, you know, obviously a husband knows his wife and wife also knows their husband. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam understood by looking at Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And that's why he said that you are like the women of Yusuf. This is in one explanation, there are various other explanations. We're going to move on. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, now his health condition is deteriorated so bad that Abu Bakr is not reading the salah. Abu Bakr led salatul Isha, and then he led next day salatul Fajr. He also led salatul Jum'ah. And also he led all the salah on Friday, also led all the salah on Saturday, all the salah on Sunday. Rasulullah SAW is not moving from his place. This is sakaratul maut. That one cannot even move. Rasulullah SAW is going through sakaratul maut, the agony of death, the pain of death. If the Prophet of Allah SAW is going through that pain, then brothers and sisters, me and you will be also will go through that pain, and Allah Subhanahu wa Taala knows best what will happen to us at that moment. On Monday morning, and it was the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal, on the Monday morning, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was Salatul Fajr time, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha to move the curtain again. When Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she moved the curtain, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw the entire masjid is filled. We are not talking about Eid Salah here, or Jummah Salah, it was Salatul Fajr. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he moved the curtain, and that day, in those days, the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't have a wall there. It was just a curtain with the masjid and the Prophet's house. They've been missing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Salatul Jum'ah. You know, people, they used to walk 5 miles to pray Jum'ah Salah with Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Awali al-Madina is near the Masjid Quba. People used to walk from Quba to come and pray Salatul Jum'ah with the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, and here suddenly they came for Jum'ah Salah, and it was Abu Bakr who was leading the Salah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wasn't there. So the entire people of Medina, they found out that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not well. You know, a Sahabi of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he narrates a hadith. He said, whenever I used to pray my Salah, I used to make sure that I stand towards the right of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So whenever I used to come, I should stand near the right. They said, why? He said, because the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he used to finish his Salah, then he used to turn towards the right. And that sight, when I should look at the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when I look at his beautiful face, this is something that I should treasure for all my life. Because the Prophet is leading people in Salah. He is thinking about the Quranic verses. The color of his face is to change. The appearance of Rasulullah is to change. And then after Salah, he used to look. And the first sight anyone gets, it was me. Therefore, I used to always pray my Salah on the right hand side of Rasulullah. People were missing looking at the Prophet of Allah for such a day. But when they saw Anas radiallahu ta'ala, he said, when we looked at the Prophet of Allah, that was the most beautiful scenery, the most beautiful sight that we have never ever seen it for such a long time. We looked at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then the Prophet smiled. You have the beautiful face of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam looking towards you, and on top of that, the Prophet smiled. That was a smile of happiness and acceptance. That all my companions continue whatever you were doing, because I have few moments left, and I will leave the world. Respected brothers and sisters, that smile was the final smile of Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That was it. After that, when the curtain was closed, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam again, he said, La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, inna lil mawti sakarat. Subhanallah, inna lil mawti sakarat. Allahumma a'inni ala sakaratil mawt. Allahumma a'inni ala ghamaratil mawt. Allahumma a'inni ala munkaratil mawt. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made dua, oh Allah, assist me. Oh Allah, help me. Help me with this agony that I'm going through, the pain that I'm going through. Oh Allah, the pain of death is severe. Oh Allah, assist me and help me. And then Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, I grabbed the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and I put him into my lap. And then Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, she came. And when Fatima came, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke to Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha. He said something to her ear. Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, she cried. Then the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he whispered something to Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, once again into her ear. Thereupon Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, she smiled. Later Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she asked that Fatima, what was that? You came in and the Prophet said something to you, I couldn't hear. And then you cried. And then the Prophet of Allah said something else, and then you smiled. Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, later she explained that the Prophet of Allah said to me that he doesn't have time left. The time of death has drawn nearer, and he will go now and meet his Lord. Therefore I cried. That today my father will leave me. Today my father will depart from me. So I cried. Then when I was crying, he called me again, as you saw. And he said that the first person from the family member of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be no one else but me. I will be the first to meet him. 6 months later, after the Prophet passed away, 6 months later, the first person to pass away from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam family member was Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha. It was the prophecy of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on that day. And then he also said to me that Ama tardain, and you happy, O Fatima, and takuni sayyidani sayy ahlil jannah, that you will be the leader of all the women of Jannah. There again, when I heard that, I also smiled. Then Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, she looked at the pain of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the time of death, and she said, Wa karba abata, wa karba abata, wa karba abata. Oh, the pain my father is going through. Oh, the pain my father is going through. Oh, the pain and agony my father is facing. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam called Fatima. The Fatima, come here. Laysa ala abiki karbun ba'da al-yawm. You don't need to cry anymore, because as from today, your father will face no more pain. Go, don't worry. As from today, your father will face no more pain. Then the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam again, he said, La ilaha illallah, inna lil mawti sakarat. As-salah, wa ma malakat aymanukum. These are the last words. This is the bequest of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, As-salah, wa ma malakat aymanukum. Be mindful of prayers. Be mindful of prayers and what your right hand possesses. And then Abdurrahman, Ibn Abi Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he came with an unused miswak, a brand new miswak. He was a young boy, he came in. He is, after all, Aisha's brother, so he doesn't need to seek permission to come in. He came in. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he looked towards Abdurrahman, the son of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. And Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said that I looked at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I knew that the Prophet of Allah, he likes to use miswak. So I said, أَخُذُهُ لَكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. O Prophet of Allah, should I grab the miswak from Abdul Rahman? فَأَشَارَ بِرَأْسِهِ نَعْمُ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with his hand, he said yes. Then Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she grabbed the miswak. And then, because the miswak was unused, so therefore she said, أُلَيِّنُهُ لَكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Should I soften this miswak for you, O Prophet of Allah? Should I moisten it? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again with his hair, he said yes. And then Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she put her saliva into that siwak, and then she gave it to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why she says the most famous hadith. She says, إِنَّ مِنْ نِعَمِ اللَّهِ عَلَيَّ أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ تُوفِيَ فِي بَيْتِي وَفِي يَوْمِي وَبَيْنَ سَحْرِي وَنَحْرِي وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ جَمَعَ بَيْنَ رِيقِي وَرِيقِهِ عِنَّ مَوْتِي. Rawahu al-Bukhari, in the hadith of Bukhari, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala, she says that one of the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exclusively for me, one of the bounty of Allah azza wa jal was that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he died in my room. I was there. Every moment the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spent, I was there with him. And fi yawmi, it was my day. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he felt, you know, he was ill, and it was the day of Aisha. And then again he went to the house of Maymun and then he came back. But the day the Prophet passed away, it was the day of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. So today she is allowed to everyone else to move. You know, leave this room or leave me alone. And the Prophet he was here 10. So she said it was my day and it was in my room. And what else? And the Prophet passed away where? Baina sahri wa nahri. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. The word sahar means bosom, and the word nahar means jugular vein, mean the throat. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away at the bosom of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and she was holding the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when the Prophet of Allah passed away, and she said, "Wa anna Allah jama'a bayna riqi wa riqihi." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mixed my saliva with the saliva of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he passed away. That's why Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said that at least this is something that I could, you know, I could rejoice with, that the Prophet of Allah passed away, you know, in happiness. That's a sign of happiness, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, has written that the Prophet of Allah will pass away in my room and in my lap, and I will be holding Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So all those people who question against, you know, against Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, they should think twice. Anyway, we're going to move on. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then he looked towards the heaven. And Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said that I could hear him. And this is only Aisha radiallahu ta'ala she narrated, because no one else was there. I could hear the Prophet of Allah saying something. And then I listened attentively, and then the Prophet of Allah, he looked towards the heaven and he said, Bir Rafiq al-A'la. Bir Rafiq al-A'la. Allahumma Bir Rafiq al-A'la. That Allah, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he looked towards the heaven and he said that with Rafiq al-A'la, with the friends of the hereafter, with the friends of the highness. And Rasulullah is choosing, you know, someone else. So Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, I said to myself, إِنَّهُ لَا يَخْتَارُنَا. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not choosing us today. Because you see the Prophet, you know, the angel of death, when they come to the Prophet, they ask permission. So the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told this angel, basically take me to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said that I knew it, that the Prophet of Allah is leaving us now. He's never going to choose us. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he left the world. When he left the world, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she came out and she made an announcement. She said, Bata Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh people, our Prophet of Allah has left us. Umar ibn al-Khattab, many have left the masjid after Salatul Fajr. Even Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anha, he led the people in Salah, and then he went to the masjid. And his house is not too far away, by the way. As I said to you, just about 20 years from the Musalla of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, towards the right. So he went inside. Umar ibn al-Khattab, when he heard the announcement, he came to the room. He said, what are you saying? And then he received permission. Aisha, can I come in? Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said, wait. And then Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she drew the curtain and she observed hijab. Because Umar radiallahu ta'ala anha is not a mahram, and he said, now you can come in. Umar ibn al-Khattab and Al-Mughira radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, they came inside. Umar ibn al-Khattab, he looked at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's lying in the floor, on the floor, and his face is covered. Umar ibn al-Khattab said, oh, wa Rasulullah. Oh, my Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Today he is unconscious. He will be conscious later on. He thought the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has not passed away. When he left the room, Mughira said, no. The Prophet, mata Rasulullah. The Prophet of Allah has passed away. He said, kathabta. What are you talking about? You are lying. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has not passed away. And anyone who said, then Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu is a huge man. You know, some companions have described Umar ibn al-Khattab that when he used to sit on the horse, okay, so picture a horse, both of his legs touch the floor. This is Umar ibn al-Khattab, he's a huge person. And then he took his sword out, another huge sword. And he said, if anyone who says that Rasulullah sallallahu has passed away, he will meet the end of my sword. Mughira said, who's going to argue with Umar ibn al-Khattab here? Okay, whatever you say, Umar, no problem. And then Umar ibn al-Khattab, he explained, he said, that moment it wasn't me. Umar ibn al-Khattab, people asked him, what happened then? He said, it wasn't me. I could not comprehend the fact that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to leave us. Prophet said, وَزِرَايَ فِي السَّمَاءِ وَزِرَايَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. I have two ministers in the heaven, I have two ministers in the heaven, in the earth. As for the heaven, Jibra'il and Mikael. Whenever they descend together. Whenever they ascend together. And you know, they are the one who took the Prophet to Mi'raj to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he had the physical ascension. So he said, I have two wazir in the heaven, I have two wazir in the earth. And they are and in the earth I have Abu Bakr and Umar. Abu Bakr and Umar. Abu Bakr and Umar. And this is Umar ibn al-Khattab. So he couldn't comprehend the fact that the Prophet of Allah, his companion, is going to leave him. So Umar ibn al-Khattab said that anyone who said that the Prophet of Allah has passed away, he would meet the end of my soul. And it was chaos in the masjid. Some are saying something, some are really scared to say anything. Umar ibn al-Khattab here, and he's got his sword and he's moving around in the masjid. Someone straight away, Salim radiallahu ta'ala, he went to Abu Bakr. He said, Abu Bakr, you need to come out. He said, what happened? He said, Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left this one. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, he ignored all the people in the masjid. He walked straight into the house, into the room of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He doesn't need to seek any permission because we have Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, that's his daughter. He went straight inside the room and he said, Aisha, where is the Prophet of Allah? She said, oh, Prophet of Allah is lying here. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was on the floor. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he would remove the veil, the cloth, and then he kissed the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam between the two eyes. And he said, طِبْتَ حَيًّا وَمَيِّتًا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ فِدَاكَ أَبِي وَأُمِّي يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ لَا يُذِيقُكَ اللَّهُ بِالْمَوْتَتَيْنِ أَبَدًا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. He said, may my father and my mother be sacrificed for you, O Prophet of Allah. You are good you are good when you are living and you are good when you die. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not make you taste two deaths. The pain that you went through, that's it, O Prophet of Allah, and there is no death to come after. And then Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala came out of the room. And he saw that some people are crying, some are raising their voice, some people are running around, and then the Umar is threatening people as well, he's got his sword out as well. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, he went straight to Umar and said, Umar, ijlis. He wanted him to calm him down. He said, Umar, ijlis. Sit down. Umar said, la. Not going to sit down. He said, ijlis, ya Umar. Umar is not listening. And Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, he went to the corner of the masjid. And he said, fahamid Allah wa athna alayh. And then he done the khutbah. Alhamdulillah, he nahmaduhu. And he praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way Allah deserved to be praised. And he thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he sent the salutation on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, Amma ba'd. As soon as Abu Bakr said, Amma ba'd, there was pin drop silence in the masjid. Everyone, they left Umar, they came to Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. And then he said, Man kana ya'budu Muhammadan, fa inna Muhammadan qad mat. Wa man kana ya'budu Allah, fa inna Allah hayyun la yamut. He who is to worship Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let him know that Muhammad has left us today, has passed away. He who worships Allah, let him know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is hayyun, he is living and is everlasting and he will never die. And then Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, we recited, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قد خلت من قبلهم الرسل أفإن مات أو قتل انقلبتم على أعقابكم ومن ينقلب على عقبيه فلن يضر الله شيئا وسيجزي الله الشاكرين. Muhammad is but a prophet. Prophets before him have passed away. If Muhammad is to die or to be killed, are you going to turn back on your heels? And the one who turned back onto his heels, فَلَنْ يَضُرُّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا, he shall do no harm to Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward those who are grateful to him. Umar ibn Khattab, he said, when I heard Abu Bakr reciting those verses, by Allah, I thought those verses were just revealed now. Although those verses were revealed long time ago, and we have already heard it in Salah, and we have recited, and I have memorized it. But that very moment, when Abu Bakr recited those verses, we thought that those verses were just revealed now. And then all of a sudden, the talk of everyone was, everyone was reciting those verses. That everyone was reciting those verses. Anyone's question about the Prophet ﷺ demise, they recited those verses. It was, you know, something that was inspired to Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. Don't forget, as Abu Sa'id al-Khudri said, وَكَانَ أَبُو بَكْرٍ أَعْلَمَنَا, he was the most knowledgeable. You know, Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, who used to know what to say at what moment. That's a knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only gives to some specific people. You know, مُقْتَضَى الْحَالِ, to say very little, but accurately at that moment. And Abu Bakr is to be one of those. And then what happened? Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala, he said that I sat down and I knew that the Prophet of Allah has left us, therefore I cried again. And everyone else cried. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's in his room. So Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, he's about to go. Everyone said, no, where are you going? You're not going anywhere. We need to talk about Khilafah now. We have to talk about who's going to be the next Khalifa. And then again disagreement started. Disagreement started as another topic, to be honest with you, about, you know, what happened. But in very short, everyone said that we have to have a Khalifa. Someone said, I've got an idea. We should have a Khalifa from Ansar, one from the Ansar, from the people of Medina, and one from the Muhajirin. And everyone said, yeah, that's a good idea. You know, that's, you know, in that case, we're going to keep everyone happy. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, he didn't want to take part into this because he's got more worry and concern about the burial of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But when he realized that the people are arguing, he said, look, one thing that I will say to you, al-aimatu min Quraysh, a Khalifa has to be from Quraysh. You see, these kind of hadith, only Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala used to know. Many other companions, they didn't know this hadith. But they cannot reject the hadith of Abu Bakr because he's the most reliable they have. And the most trustworthy person is Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. And then when Abu Bakr is to say something, others to back up as well. He said, yes, I heard it as well. Now everyone has remembered the hadith. So Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, anyway, when he said this hadith, and everyone, then Umar ibn Khattab, he grabbed the hand of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala and he said, look, Abu Bakr is the most knowledgeable. Abu Bakr is someone that would lead us in Salah as well. Abu Bakr is someone that the Prophet of Allah has accepted, you know, was happy with. Abu Bakr is one of the first to accept Islam. And Umar ibn Khattab began to praise Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu and said, I'm the first to do bay'ah. And therefore everyone else come. And therefore the bay'ah was done and Abu Bakr was appointed to be the Khalifa. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he gave a khutbah. And after the khutbah, now he said, we need to bury the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, she is crying now as well. And she's saying, wa abata, she could not stop crying. And she said, wa abata, oh my father, wa abata, oh my father, wa abata, oh my father, ajaba rabban da'a. My father has answered to the call of Allah who was calling. Wa abata, oh my father, jannatul firdausi ma'wa, jannatul firdaus will be his final destination. Wa abata, ila jibreel an'a. Oh my father, shall we inform Jibreel of your demise, of your death? Because from now on, Jibreel not coming down anymore. That's what the last time that Jibreel will come down. Because Jibreel is the malak. He's the angel of what? Of Risala, to bring revelation to the Prophet. But after the Prophet of Allah, Jibreel also knew that he's not going to come down. That's why Fatima said, should I inform Jibreel that that's it now, you're not going to come down anymore. So, shall we inform Jibreel, O Prophet of Allah? This was some of the words that Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said. Now, Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anha, when everyone they came to watch the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, again the debate happened, how do we watch the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? So what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused everyone to sleep. You know, everyone basically all of a sudden, a sakina overpowered them. And then a voice came from the room that, do not take off the clothes of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, leave the Prophet of Allah the way he is dressed. You could wash the Prophet of Allah, but you know, do not take off his clothes. And then they washed the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Aisha, she was there. She didn't participate in the washing and in the bathing, but she said that لو استقبلت من أمري ما استدبرت ما غسل النبي إلا نساؤه. She said that if I could go back now, then I would not let anyone wash the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam except me and all other wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because what happened was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he came inside the room once, and then Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was in the room, and when she said that, oh Prophet of Allah, with such a bad headache, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said that, ma barraki, you know, you should not worry, O Aisha, if you were to die before me, then I will wash you, I will bathe you, and I will also do your burial, and I will do everything, you don't need to worry, I will do everything with my own hand, you know. And there is an ikhtilaf, whether a husband could wash his wife and etc., but that's for tomorrow. So anyway, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this. When Aisha radiallahu ta'ala, she said that, you know, I would not let anyone wash the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nevertheless, the companion, they washed the Prophet of Allah in his own clothes. And then they used the kafan to cover the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then again another debate started. And that is, what do we do with the body of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Who's going to lead the Prophet of Allah in Salat al-Janazah? That's another debate. Again, a voice came that no one's going to be Imam today. No one's going to be the Imam. And no one's going to go and do a Janazah the way we normally pray Janazah. You will go to the room and you just pray and come back. So people will come in group. So first the men came, then the women came, then the children came, and people came in groups. The Prophet passed away on Monday, he's getting buried on Wednesday. So don't forget. Because of the debate of this Khilaf and all these other debates that took place. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Janazah is finished now. Now the debate again came, where he's going to be buried. And again some said that we should take him to Jannat al-Baqi. He will be with his family members. His son Ibrahim is there. Two of his daughters are buried there. Some of his wives is buried there as well. And there are many other relatives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like Uthman ibn Mas'ud, and many others are buried there. So we should take him to Jannat al-Baqi. And this was the view. Then again, no one spoke except for Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an. He said to the nearest meaning, مَا قُبِدَ نَبِيٌّ إِلَّا دُفِنَ حَيْثُ قُبِلَ. That a prophet is buried wherever he dies. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no sudden death for the prophets. Me and you, as Allah says, وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُونَ. We don't know when we're going to die. You know, at the time of Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, he was lecturing Sulaiman alayhi salam, and there was a man in the gathering. And then, Sulaiman, when he was lecturing, he saw that that man was actually giving a nasty look at someone else. You know, he's giving, as we say in our language, dirty looks to someone. You know, and that man then, when he looked at him, he got very angry as well. He said, why is he looking at me like that? You know, often we get very angry as well. This man is looking at me, let's sort him out. So he was very angry as well. He said, why is he looking at me like this? You know, so he got up. He's not going to have a gathering, he's not going to have a fight in the gathering of Sulaiman, I'm the Prophet of Allah. He got up and he came to Sulaiman. And I said, oh, Prophet Sulaiman, can you please tell this man not to look at me like this? Look at him, he's giving me a bad look. Sulaiman said, can you not look at him like this, please? So he came and he whispered to Sulaiman, so Sulaiman, I'm not a normal man. I came in the form of a man so that people don't get scared. I am the angel of death. I'm looking at him and I'm surprised. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla has told me that this person is going to die 500 kilometers away from here. And there's only a few moments left. And I'm so worried that what is he doing here when Allah told me that I'm going to actually take his soul from somewhere else, which is 500 kilometers from here. That's why I'm looking at him like this. So Sulaiman says, you don't need to worry, that's the angel of death. So, right? Then he's got a few moments left, yes. He said, please, you know, you control the wind, you fly around, please tell the wind to take me 500 kilometers away from that island over there. He said, no problem. So Sulaiman said, oh wind, you know, take him away. And then he went to that land, and as he reached that land, angel of death said, this is what I was waiting for. This is something that he used to turn away from. This is something that he used to reject, and he took the soul away. So we don't know who we're going to die, Allah Azza wa Jalla knows. But the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, they know the land, they know the place, they know the time. Because as I said to you, the angels come and they ask permission. If you remember the hadith of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, the angel of death came to him. And again, these are the hadith of mutashabihat. We cannot understand this, but the Prophet of Allah told us, therefore we should, you know, we don't have to dwell too much into it. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that when the angel of death came to Musa alaihi wasallam, Musa asked him, who are you? He said, I'm the angel of death. Musa punched him. What are you doing here? And he punched him so much that Musa actually gave him a black eye. That's the word of the hadith, that he went to Allah Azza wa Jal, that, oh Allah, you have sent me to a servant that he's not willing to die. He doesn't want to die. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent that, go back to Musa alayhi salam and tell him that if he were to put his hand onto the skin of a buffalo, every space that his hand covers, every hair that he touches, he will get that many years to live. So, you know, subhanAllah, if you were to touch a buffalo, for example, how many hairs you will cover? Surely more than 500 to 600. Or even more than that. So when the angel came to Musa alayhi salam, he said, Allah Azza wa Jal is saying, Musa alayhi salam said, but ask Allah, what's going to happen after that? Okay, I don't mind living for 700-800 years, but what's going to happen after? He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, even after that you have to die. He said, if that's the case, then I am ready now. But one request to my Lord, I want to go to al-Ard al-Muqaddasa. That's the final request. Because what happened, remember, when he left Egypt, and he was in the area, Wadi Tin, you know, they were, you know, wandering around in that wadi, in that valley, near Jordan, as some of the archaeologists tells us anyway. But he was very near al-Ard al-Muqaddasa, Palestine. But he said, my last request to Allah, that I want to be a stone throw away from Palestine. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his dua, and the Musa, he was walking towards Palestine. And then, and as he came near, just the outskirts of Musa's grave, I visited the grave just recently, a month ago, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he passed away and he's buried there. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if I was there, I would have showed you his grave, عند الكثيب الأحمر. And he's just near Al-Kathib Al-Ahmar, near the area, the sun is called Al-Kathib Al-Ahmar, is when the sun is a bit reddish, it's called Al-Kathib Al-Ahmar. He said, I exactly know where Musa al-Islam is buried. And subhanAllah, this grave, this place was actually first recognized by Salahuddin al-Ayyubi, rahimahullah ta'ala, when he conquered, when he liberated Palestine. And when he went to Palestine, he actually first found the grave of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. So we have, you know, a sanad goes to Salahuddin al-Ayyubi. Anyway, so Musa alayhi salam, he knew where he's going to die. The prophets, they know, but we do not know. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, about burial Abu Bakr, said that a prophet is buried wherever he dies. Therefore, he will be buried here in the house of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And therefore, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was buried in the house of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. Especially brothers, we are talking about sakaratul maut. That our Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not for one day, not for 2 days, for 12 consecutive days, he felt the sakaratul maut, the agony of death. If Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam felt that pain at the time of death, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will know what me and you will go through. Because this is something that we cannot escape from. But the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they did not give up the good deeds after the demise of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They didn't. Rasulullah, he passed away. The companions of Rasulullah, they continue with the good deeds. They continue with the good work. They follow the sunnah of Rasulullah. Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. You know, how many of us here know the father of Bilal? Anyone? Bilal ibn Rabah. Anyone know the grandfather of Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu? No one knows. Even I don't know. None of the Mufassirin, of the Muhaddithin, no one knows. No one knows the grandfather of Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Everyone knows Bilal ibn Rabah. They know his father and that's it. But subhanAllah, the word Bilal is known to everyone. He was a slave, his father was a slave, his grandfather was a slave, his great-grandfather was a slave. You know, slavery was written in his family, in his lineage. But when he said, La ilaha illallah, he became the Muaddin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first person to call Adhan in Mecca, at the conquest of Mecca, was Bilal radiallahu ta'ala. The first person to call Adhan in Madinah al-Munawwara was Bilal radiallahu ta'ala an. And, I don't know if you know this, the first person to call out the adhan in Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa at the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab was Bilal radiallahu ta'ala an. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, he built the Masjid Al-Aqsa. He found the exact location where the Prophet he prayed. He left the 124,000 Prophets in Salah and he said, I'm going to build the Masjid here. And then Umar ibn al-Khattab said, Bilal, come here, you call out the adhan. And Bilal called the adhan. When the people heard the adhan of Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they cried, remembering the days of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Bilal in his deathbed now. He's in Damascus, near Al-Bab al-Sakhir. He's away from his friends, family members. Where is Medina? Where is Damascus? There's no one there with him. Only his wife. And then Bilal is going through sakarat al-maut, ghamarat al-maut. And Bilal is also, he's got tears in his eyes as well. And his wife thought that he's crying because he's dying today. And then she said, Wa Bilala, Wa Huzna, oh my sorrow, oh my grief, oh Bilal, oh my husband. Bilal radiallahu anhu said, No, Wa Farha, oh my happiness. Ghadan Nalqal Ahibba, Muhammadan wa Sahba. Tomorrow I'm going to be with my beloved ones. I'm going to be with Muhammad and the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is Bilal radiallahu anhu. Because the companions, they knew that if you continue with the good deeds, if you follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you continue with the bequest of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which was as-salah, that be mindful of prayer, be mindful of prayer, and what your right hand possess, we have huququllah and we have huququl ibad. Huququllah, the rights of Allah, is salah, starting from salah and all other ibadah. And huququl ibad, you have to be kind to your neighbors, you have to be kind to your people, and especially those what your right hand possess, i.e. The slaves and etc. Huququl ibad, and you have huququllah. If you do these two things, then we are ready to die. We are ready to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are ready to be with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is what the companions they did. So respected brothers and elders and sisters, we are here to prepare for the death. We are here in this dunya to prepare for the hereafter. Because death is something that we cannot get away from. بِاللَّهِ يَا نَفْسُ إِسْمَعِي وَعْقِلِي مَقَالَةً قَدْ قَالَهَا نَاصِحُ لَا يَنْفَعُ الْإِنسَانَ فِي قَبَرِهِ إِلَّا التُّقَى وَالْعَمَلُ الصَّالِحُ A poet says, Oh my soul, listen attentively. And listen to the advice that someone is giving you, sincere advice. Listen to this. That when someone will pass away, then in the grave nothing will help him except إِلَّا التُّقَى وَالْعَمَلُ الصَّالِحُ Except the piety and the good deeds. We are here to do the good deeds. You know, the study that we are doing is good deeds. The prayer that we are praying are good deeds. So we are here to do the good deeds because this is the only thing that will benefit us. يَتْبَعُ الْمَيْتَ ثَلَاثِ When we die, three things follows us. أَهْلُهُ وَمَالُهُ وَعَمَلُهُ Our family members will follow us. They will come to the graveyard with us. Yes, they will bury us. And our wealth will also will follow us as well. You know, you're dying and you'll have the thing that you possess because after all, they will do the burial from your money. So your money also is following you. And وَعَمَلُهُ And your deeds also follow you. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, يَرْجِعْ إِثْنَانِ Two things will come back and one thing will remain with you. يَرْجِعُ أَهْلُهُ وَمَالُهُ His wealth and his family will come back and only thing will remain with him is what? Is the good deed that if he has done anything. If he has done any good deed, then that's the only thing will remain. And this is why Ali radiallahu ta'ala we said, النَّفْسُ تَبْهِي عَلَى الدُّنْيَا وَقَدْ عَلِمًا أَنَّ السَّلَامَةَ مِنْهَا تَرْكُ مَا فِيهَا Whatever we possess, brothers and sisters in this world, we will leave this behind. We will leave this behind. We will leave everything behind. لَا دَارَ لِلْمَرْءِ بَعْدَ الْمَوْتِ يَسْكُنُهَا إِلَّا الَّتِي كَانَ قَبْلَ الْمَوْتِ يَبْنِيهَا فَإِنْ بَنَاهَا بِخَيْرٍ طَابَ مَسْكَنُهُ وَإِنْ بَنَاهَا بِشَرٍ خَابَ بَانِيهَا That you have no house to live in the hereafter, except for the house that you have built in this world. If you have built that house with good deeds, then that house will be pleasure to live in. But if you have built that house with your bad deeds, then I'm afraid the one who has built that house will be a failure and he will be in greater danger. Therefore, respected brothers and sisters, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to prepare for death. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to prepare for the day when nothing will help us except for the good deeds. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal that may our last words will be La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Man kana akhir kalamihi La ilaha illallah dakhala al-jannah. If someone's last word will be La ilaha illallah, then you will enter paradise. Because at that time, brothers, you know, it's not how many times we practice here, it is the good deed that we will do here, that's going to help us. And that is the moment that La ilaha illallah will come from our mouth. There was a muhaddith, rahimahullah ta'ala. You know, he was on his deathbed and they were talking about hadith and they missed a person in the chain. And the person that they missed in the chain, it was the person who was lying in his deathbed. So therefore, when they were saying that, who's that person missing in the, you know, in the chain of narration? And then he said, that it's me. And then he mentioned his name and then he finished the hadith and he said, yes, it is me and then I narrate from him and he narrates from his teacher who narrates from Abu Huraira who said, man kana akhir kalamihi la ilaha illallah dakhala al-jannah and then he died as well. Because all his life he was writing hadith, therefore he died in hadith. How many of you heard the name of Mujahid ibn Jabr al-Makki? He was the student of Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an. He is someone that he used to live in Quran and hadith. You know, they used to call him walking to Quran and hadith. Because all his life was, you know, learning about the hadith and narrating about the hadith. You know, so many, if you read the tafsir in Sahih al-Bukhari, Bab al-Tafsir, every hadith Imam Bukhari narrates from Mujahid rahimahullah ta'ala. So he was the Imam of Tafsir, he was the Imam of Hadith as well. And then, when the time of death came, they found him that he's actually, he went to sajda and he said, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, and then he passed away. In sajda. It is so the good deed that you do, and you continue with those good deeds, and then when the death will come, it will come at the time that you will be doing that good deeds. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq to prepare for death. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله.